What's up, guys? Welcome to the 59th episode of The Get Down. My name is Cream.
Gary W. here.
Busy week, man. We're like cranking already. Gary just got home.
Yeah, late last night, got home, hung out a little bit, and back at it.
Yeah, this is going to be like straight to business podcast because we got shit to do, right?
Right. Yeah, keep it moving today. But no, it was a great weekend all around. I was looking forward to coming up and especially playing, in particular, Birch. Just don't play big rooms like that very often.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess like Ashford's a big room, but like Birch is
not
like,
the same.
They're not parallel.
They're both big rooms and there's a lot of people at Ashford, but your actual dance floor is a fraction of what's actually in the building.
Right.
So it's a little different.
Birch was insanity. I literally did not leave the booth all night. It was, there was too many people there.
Yeah.
Like shoulder to shoulder, insane. Too many people. So I didn't even step out of the booth, but the vibe was great in the place. People stayed till close pretty much.
Yeah. It was busy late. Like I looked up and I'm like, man, it's 2:10 and there's still probably like 400 people in here.
Yeah. Well, what we closed 3:30 closed, right?
No, we closed at like 2:40 and we turned the lights on kind of early because it was so busy. They wanted to start getting people out the door.
Trizzo's jumped back on like 2.
Yeah, around 2.
Right.
And probably played till 2:30 or so. Yeah, about that.
A great time. Good times. Anybody that missed it, next time that we play up there, we'll definitely promote the shit out of it.
Yeah, there's been a few things I'll say after that set. First, you and I have not really had a set where it was just so seamless and it just flowed from start to finish.
Right.
We played open to close, which was cool. Yeah. We were jumping back and forth every 45 and it was just like the flow of the night was perfect. I think we both played to our strengths as far as the music we played. And it was just a vibe. Yeah. You know, as a DJ, you know, when it was really good, it was really good. Like it was really good. And then the feedback we got from everybody afterwards who worked there and who was hanging out was really good. I have a call with the team at Birch today and I'm expecting pretty high praise, but we'll see what they say. I'm sure they made good money that night.
I was going to say, I'm sure the ring was crazy.
And that'll help those guys be really happy about it. So I would expect a Gary and Cream set at Birch sooner than later.
Hopefully.
But yeah, great weekend.
Shocked me because like you said, we don't normally play that great together for whatever reason that is.
Yeah.
I mean, we've played like a fair amount, but our art styles are just so different.
I think the last time we played together was like pandemic seated and it was just weird.
Yeah, true.
And I think that's why it felt so weird because we're playing a big room and they're like asking us to go hard and it's like no one's up and dancing. So it just felt weird, I think.
Yeah. That was one of my bigger sets. I don't usually play that big for that long.
Yeah.
But it was fun. It was a good time.
So I don't know. The first topic that I think we want to get into a little bit is something we've been doing a lot of, and it's connecting people, right? I think like at the end of the day, connecting people is kind of like our job description, right? So it's connecting the right DJ with the right venue for their skill set. It's connecting, you know, the right private event DJ with the right event, whether it's a wedding or whatever it might be, understanding what those venues and people's needs are and putting them together. Right.
I think it's a lot of different things here. Cause we can talk about just basic connections that we have that are not like DJ related that then also become clients or whatever, you know, whatever it might be. Knowing our staff and the ins and outs of like exactly who likes to do what, who's really like what people's strong points are. I think that's what we're good at. And then connecting them with the various, because I'm like thinking about all our guys and like all our guys can be placed in so many different areas of DJing, whether it be private event, corporate event, nightclub, dive bar, because we do. We have to deal with all that stuff. And then,
they all have different skill sets and different places where they want to be, you know? So it's juggling a lot.
And then I think about like Midnight Market. That's such like a niche thing that we have a great relationship with them, but it's such a niche booking because it's like, as we've talked about with that event, like it's still a featured food event. It's not a dance club event. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you still want to lay in the cut enough to where the food kind of shines and the actual point of the event shines. So like placing a DJ at that, like that's kind of, you have to be a pro to handle that event properly. That's just one not strange event, but something that's not normal, right?
Real
that
quickly
kind of pops off.
I'm going to plug this event. Midnight Market in Jersey City is happening next Friday. It's our first one in a long time. It's at 902 Brewery in Jersey City. It's going to be a super cool event. Angel the Kid's DJing. Tone Setta is DJing. B-Fine is DJing. Amazing food. Tons of great beer. It's a super cool event. We'll put the link to buying tickets in the show notes and actually also in our IG bio. Awesome event. I will be there as a guest because I just love going and hanging out. I would go even if we weren't booking DJs.
Right.
So if you haven't heard about it or you want it, you love food, you love music, this is a great event for you. So come check it out. So sorry to interrupt, but I wanted to get that in.
No, yeah. I mean, it's complete accident. I guess that's top of mind. That's why I brought it up. But like, that's one of the, like I said, that's one of those niche events and UFO. So when I used to go to it prior to us even being DJs there, we weren't even looking to be working there. We were just going to hang out. So yeah, that's definitely a great event. 902 Brewery is supposed to be super, super dope. I was trying to go to a show there over the weekend, but just didn't have time. Anyway, so back to connections. So yeah, like there's that. And then like, I think about like the smaller dive bars that we book and like how particular like those DJs need to be in order to shine at those types of places. And we always get great feedback from those places because I feel like some of the guys that we push, like Bryant does a great job at those like more local spots. You know, Bryant does a good job everywhere, but
yeah.
Particularly like that he's always loved at those kind of things. And then, you know, we used to have that Newark Airport corporate account, which was a incredible account from a monetary standpoint. but it was so strange. Like you set up in the hallway of Newark Airport in front of the food court and you're like playing music and it seems so out of place.
I met so many random crazy musicians and people doing that. It was super cool.
Yeah. And
like world class sax player that would just come and hang out and vibe for like 20 minutes before he had to hop on his flight. Like it was crazy.
I remember I booked like two private events out of that. Like it's just like, you never know, like this, you never know the situations that you get put in and you have to use those situations, you know, to kind of broaden your connections.
Yeah. What I brought this up because we've had multiple meetings with all these different entities and companies and entertainment companies and just trying to figure out ways that maybe we could work together. And I was able to connect two of those companies this week and they're going to work an event on Friday, which is super cool. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to bring this up. But it's like, I think for us, it's like, we want to be able to, if someone calls us and say, hey, Gary, we need XYZ. If we can't do it, be able to deliver someone or some company that can do it. And I think what we always say is if someone comes to us, we want to be able to say, I got you, whether it's 1 hour away, 5 hours away, a month away, 6 months away, and just being reliable and being able to do that no matter what the request is. And I think that's something that's really helped us a lot in growing our business and being able to, even if it doesn't initially help us, or even if it doesn't help us at all, it just puts us in a good light with those people because we were able to help them do something they're trying to do.
You know, you don't want to be a yes man, but you have to be, right? You like what I mean is that the minute you say no to somebody, they're on to the next person. You're forgotten about.
Right. We talk about it when we book DJs.
Yeah.
Same thing. If you say no to us, we probably won't go to you the next time. At least the first choice.
Right, exactly. But you also want to be able to deliver. We are now seasoned enough to have a lot of connections, and we can deliver upon pretty much any request in the entertainment world, right?
Yeah.
So you want, you know, so we're able to be yes men because we have a lot of tools at our disposal. You don't want to get caught flat-footed though and say yes and then not be able to deliver properly. Right. So you got to tread that line lightly. But yeah, like be a yes man, especially if you're being asked to go DJ somewhere, like by a booker, and you want to work with that booker. Even if you have another, you have to always weigh those options. Even if you have another event, you have to figure out, well, which one's going to be more beneficial to me.
Right.
You know, we've talked about that numerous times.
Well, the connection and the relationship is more important than the short-term dollar amount, right?
Yeah.
And we've talked about free work before. I got killed on a COVA live stream because I was talking about free work and people weren't really understanding that I'm okay with doing free work for the long term, right? I'm not going to do it for the short term to go be able to play a venue that I want to play. But if I can create a relationship that's going to maybe turn into a $20,000, $30,000 a year down the line or some bigger events, like that free work makes sense. And connecting people is free, right? It takes time for us to be like, hey, call this person. Are you available to do this? Can you do this? Meet this person. I don't expect to make a dollar out of that. But what I do expect is that the next time either one of those companies needs something in the DJ world or might need a DJ or whatever, hopefully they think of Get Down, right? And that's where the doing the free work and creating the relationship through making connections can sometimes create a really long-term relationship that can make you a shit ton of money down in a year, you know? And yeah. I think that goes by the wayside sometimes when you're thinking about growing a relationship and creating a connection.
Gosh, in 2004, I think it was, I got a call by the private event company that I was working for that I was just trying to make money on the weekend. So I was doing these 40-year-old birthdays and all this stuff that I didn't want to be doing at 20 years old. And I got a call and was like, oh, do you want to go do happy hour at Dark Horse in Morristown? It's like $100. It's like, no, absolutely. In my mind, I'm like, no, I do not want to do this. It's like,
yeah,
it's a terrible spot. Like the spot, meaning the time of the gig, it was like 4 o'clock. There was nobody there. The money was horrible.
Yeah. Like you're in a basement over there too.
Yeah. Like nobody's going to happy hour at this place. Right. But I'm like, all right, I'll do it. Like these guys book me out for stuff. They look at me as the nightlife DJ. So they're going to send me to this spot because they had a connection there. So I go and play and I turn out to be the booker of the place, you know, years later, and then wind up playing in Morristown until what, like 2-3 years ago. So
yeah, well over 10 years.
Went on like a crazy run out there where it was like a 15-year run in Morristown just because I took this $100 happy hour. But Johnny Mack, big shout to him. You know, he knew to place me over there because that was more of what I was interested in, not the private event stuff. So like, that's what, like, just saying like that, having connections and him knowing kind of where to place me, even at that young age, was really beneficial to me. And then me stepping up to take that gig led to something bigger down the line.
Yeah. And you know, I brought up free work. I don't necessarily think it has to be free work. It could just be work that's under your value, right? Under the number that you would normally take. So if you're new to getting $400 and they're asking you to do something for $250, if you want to grow that relationship, maybe you say yes and say, listen, this is my normal rate, but I want to create a relationship with you. So I'm willing to help you out and do this, but moving forward or after 2 gigs or 5, whatever it is, you have to draw that line in the sand and be like, this is what I need to be making in order to feel comfortable working with you. But I do want to work with you, right? I bring this up sometimes. It's harder in the DJ world to offer free work, so to speak, right? Because it's your time and you're going to work a gig and, you know, it's doing something for free might not help you in the long run sometimes. But think about Brandon Barris, who worked with us, right? He basically created his entire portfolio for his business that he's very successful, making a lot of money, starting doing stuff for free for us and working as an intern. Angel the Kid started with us doing stuff for free behind the scenes and then started getting bookings and took full advantage of his bookings. It started out as low in bookings and then started growing. Tim Vu, free work with us, doing stuff as an intern behind the scenes, started getting bookings, started getting good feedback, growing the gigs, better gigs, more money. Like there's a way that you can do this that can help you in the long run, that it makes sense.
Man, 59 episodes and technical difficulties still.
Few things and far between, but it happens sometimes.
Things get finicky sometimes. No, but I was saying, like, when you are just starting out or you're trying to create a relationship, you have to be, you can't be short-sighted. You know, it's quick to go out there and grab a gig that, oh, like, is going to monetarily help me out in the short term. Right? Like, you have to sometimes bite the bullet and figure it out for long-term relationships when it can definitely be more beneficial to you.
You have to think long-term.
Always.
Always.
And I think when you're younger, it's easy to be short-sighted, right? It's because you just don't have the experience or the wisdom that comes as you grow in this business. So it's just for you younger DJs out there, like, it's just something to keep in mind constantly. Like, look to see. Yeah, you just have to look like a year down the road or 6 months down the road. It can't just be next. What's next weekend or what's the weekend after that? And realistically, have a long-term plan, like career plan, in place in order to understand where you need to be in that 6 months to a year. We talk about this. We'll probably talk about this in about a month. Talk about like starting to create goals for the following year.
Yeah.
Because that's just a topic that we come up with every November, but it's just, that's good to kind of check in with when you're doing your bookings. Like, is this working out for me, for my goals in a year from now, you know? And if it's not, how can I now create connections with people to get me to that place? You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, create a target list of people or groups that you want to work with, and then figure out ways to meet them. Like, it's just like targeting venues that you want to work at as an individual DJ. You could do the same thing with hospitality groups or DJ groups or music pools, whatever it might be. You have to create those lists of people that you do want to work with and places that you do want to be at.
Yeah.
And I think, go ahead. Sorry.
There's plenty of ways now to create. You just absolutely create by yourself the opportunity. There's, you know, whether it be a Twitch stream or just Instagram or whatever, TikTok, whatever it might be. Like, you can reach the people that are doing these bookings pretty easily, and they can see your talent. You can showcase your talent all over the place. You will be seen. If you're talented, you will be seen.
Yeah.
It's just that simple. It's not like it was pre-social media. Like, it's very easy to get your name out there.
And you connect with the people who make decisions.
Right. This wasn't a fathomable thing back in like the mid-2000s. It was very difficult to get in front of the people that were doing the bookings. Like, you know, when like R3 Ventures did all the bookings and like they'd have AM come in and, you know, remember like Deco Lounge and all that, like, and then like Clutch was like playing in the basement. It's like, well, how do I get in front of those people when they're not working? It was very hard.
Yeah.
And then like fast forward to now, like, you can get in front of the 4 a.m. people pretty easily. You know, it's just wild. You just have to put in the work. Like, look at what Angelo does and all the work. I know we always talk about Angelo, but like, he puts in the work. He's a hardworking guy, and he gets his sound out there and people know who he is, you know, for that reason that he is. He just has the hunger to do it. Right.
Right. Like, if you're not putting mixes and edits and working on production and your marketing and posting on Instagram, like, you got to be doing all that shit. And
yeah,
if you're not, someone else is, and it's going to help them grow faster than you. And that's just how it is now. And it's like, yeah, you said it best, where you got to put the work in. Something I want to jump back to, when we were talking about like when you're working with these people, either whether it's for under your value or less than your value or free or whatever it might be, right? You're going to know pretty quickly if they're actually trying to create a relationship with you or if they're just using and abusing you. If they're using and abusing you, you got to jump ship, right? If they're looking to create a relationship with you, you should be able to have those open conversations about what your goals are, why you wanted to work with them in the first place, and what you're trying to do. Like, I think you need to make it known, because if you don't make it known, they're just going to ask you to do things that they need you to do.
We've seen DJs in the past get dragged through the ringer, because, and what I mean, like where there was just no growth within the company that they were at, and like they should have jumped ship and it just didn't happen, you know? And some, like if you get dragged like that, it can absolutely ruin your career. Like, you have to know when is when, when I gotta go. And if you're not able to have those open conversations comfortably, then you gotta switch up and go somewhere else.
Yeah.
That's how you know. Like, if you're not comfortable with the people that are hiring you, like, yeah, you gotta move on. Like, it's not working out.
Yeah. I think a lot of this conversation is for the newer guys, right? That might not have a name yet or aren't working regularly, or like the guys that are out there gigging hard and making $400 or $500 or $300 or whatever it is multiple times a week. You kind of know what your value is, and it's a lot harder to go below your value once you set a certain level, right? And it's hard to set a level. And when you jump up a level, you got to pull all those bookings that are under that level up to that level. And it's not easy, but that's like what you have to do. But for the younger guys, you just have to get your name out there and make those relationships if you're not working. And sometimes when you're not working and you want to make these things, you have to go below your value. So before I get killed again for talking about free shit, establish DJs that have value and have some sort of presence in the market already. This doesn't go for you as much. It might in very certain specific situations. You know, if there's one venue that you're really trying to break into and it's below your value and it's an opening set or something to open for an act, maybe you do it, right? But like anything else, you've already set your market value kind of thing.
Yeah. We say it all the time. It's so hard when you talk money. It's so hard.
It's always a situational conversation. It's very hard to talk broadly about this because every situation and every person, it's going to be different, you know, it just is. So,
yeah, but it's important to have like, to have some money to fall back on to where you can create opportunity, with being a little more choosy about your work. You know what I mean? Like, all right, well, yes, I would love to go make that $300 today, but I could take this $250 gig or $200 gig that I think I can get a lot more bookings with the people that booked me there, whether that's an owner that booked me or a DJ group, whatever it might be. It's just not having to nickel and dime every gig opportunity. You know what I mean? Yeah. And being like, okay, well, I can do this once a month where I can go and take like an outlandish booking or something, not outlandish, but something that is not my normal in order for me.
We've talked about this before of like how you think about booking out your month, right?
Yeah. So I think it's important to be in a safe place financially where you're able to do that once a month or twice a month, whatever it might be.
Yeah.
That's another thing that goes into your yearly planning or your 6 month planning. Just like you should be set up like that financially in order to be a little more flexible with your business.
Yeah. Like I'll give you an example of something I did that while I was already headlining gigs, right? So a few years back, I was working my normal stuff. And I was approached when they were opening HQ at Ocean Resort Atlantic City. And they asked me to come down. They weren't going to give me a room. I had to buy a room. But they asked me to do two gigs, right? One was like the soft opening where the owners of the entire place were there. and all the big wigs, Mark Wahlberg, Jamie Foxx, all the investors were there, right? So they asked me to do that gig. It was okay. It was like okay pricing, but it was a good opportunity. And then I was going to open the club that weekend as well, right?
Right.
No room. I had to pay for the room. But I knew that this was an opportunity at a new venue that was super dope to get my foot in the door. And I just did it. You know, I didn't even have a ride home. I was going to say,
you didn't even have a car. We were in Philly when you got this.
Right. I didn't even have a ride home. I literally had to, I had to get to Iron Bar in Morristown that night after working some gigs. And I like called a million taxi. I ended up taking a taxi, like a contracted taxi from Atlantic City to Belmar, and then took my roommate's car from Belmar to Iron Bar to make my gig at night. And all that extra work and not making and spending money to play gigs ended up getting me a monthly residency opening for big acts for like 6 months.
Yeah.
And so like, that's the kind of thing where, you know, sometimes you have to look at an opportunity and be like, all right, this is worth it. All this crap that I had to do was worth it. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. We just made it work. You know, we were hanging out in Philly. You got the phone call and was like, well, let's wrap up lunch, 'cause we got to go to Atlantic City.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what we did. We were at the market, right? We were at the market down there eating, and it's like, well, we got to go. We got to go like right now, and just made it happen. But it wound up being beneficial long term for you, for sure. That room was, and it still is. It's a dope spot. So yeah, we knew that it was going to be worth it.
Yeah, one of my favorite rooms, definitely. All right, so I think we've kind of beaten this up long enough. So the next thing we kind of wanted to talk about, now that we're here in mid-October, I think it's a great opportunity as club DJs who maybe dabble into private events to start thinking about corporate events and holiday events, because there's going to be a ton of them this year for a lot of reasons. And corporate, these holiday parties and corporate events are a great opportunity to still represent your nightlife and DJ brand and make a shit ton of money. Because these corporate entities have not been in the office. They've maybe downsized, their office space and saving money there. They haven't gotten together as a team. I think this holiday season is going to be ridiculous with the amount of money that people are willing to spend and just the amount of actual parties that are going to happen. This might be the first time that teams are getting together in over whatever it is, 2 years almost.
Yeah. A lot of my friends that work corporate, they're still working from home, and like their dates keep getting pushed. And it looks like around November is when a lot of these places are going back.
Yeah.
So yeah, these holiday parties are going to be, they're definitely going to be throwing money around, and they're really amazingly paid gigs.
Yeah.
And they're fun too. Most of the time, it's not like, because like you said, you can represent your nightlife brand and bring that whole, your whole real style to the table. Whereas like when you're doing a wedding, you have to really cater to your client. So yeah, well, let's talk about like, what are some good ways for people to reach out to corporate entities and you know, who are the people that need to be talked to? Because I think that's the biggest question mark for most DJs that are looking to dabble in this.
I think where people struggle with this is they expect that the current, like the ways that you promote your nightlife brand should be the same ways that you promote your corporate bookings, or even just letting people know that you're doing them. So you have to go to the platforms that the people who are doing these bookings are spending time, right? So for me, there's two platforms that none of us spend a lot of time on that I think you need to go and make sure you have a presence.
Yeah.
So number one would be LinkedIn. If you don't have a LinkedIn profile for your DJ business, go create one. It's not hard. You can take the copy and all the stuff that you've done and create a platform and really focus on doing corporate events and private events and being available to do so. I think that's the first thing. The second thing is Facebook, man. Like, a lot of us don't go on Facebook anymore, but the older generation of people who many times are the ones who are making these bookings or making these decisions, That's where they are. And I think if you just make some posts around, hey, I'm willing and able and available to work your holiday parties or corporate parties, your network will see that and be like, oh, well, I didn't think they did that. I didn't know they did that. So maybe I'll hit up Gary about doing my whatever Google holiday party, because I'm the person in charge of creating the event at Google. And I think that can also go across Instagram, because a lot of the younger companies, the tech companies, are going to have younger people that are also doing the bookings. But just coming up with a plan and a strategy and maybe a very simple graphic that says, hey, I'm open and available to booking your holiday and corporate parties.
A couple little things that I'm thinking about, like how to market toward these types of accounts. I think like a good professional headshot would be good, right? It doesn't have to be like super corny or whatever, but it should be a nice, clear, professional headshot.
Yeah.
I think that's important. I think good copy, just like something, you know, you don't want to come off. It doesn't have to be like DJ slang. It shouldn't be. It needs to be professional.
It's got to
be professional. And I think, like you said, like a good graphic, a nice, simple graphic.
Canva 101, something really easy. Take a template and just put your information in.
It's real simple stuff. And like, those are three main things I think that are very important that would make you a little more sellable. Because you got to think about like how nightlife graphics and nightlife copy, it's completely different.
Right.
So you want to attract, you want to come off a little more professional than you do as like for your nightlife stuff.
I think one of the other obstacles that some DJs might be facing is like, hey, I don't really have the gear to go and do one of these events. I think if you don't have the gear, you know someone that works for a private event company, you know someone that owns a private event company, reach out to them and say, hey, I have this opportunity. I think we could both make money on it. Can you help me in providing sound or whatever you need for this particular event and coming up with some sort of a revenue share? And I think that's a great way, because those companies are going to all jump at the opportunity as well. So it's a win-win for you, the DJ, and then for also the company that you're going to approach that does this regularly and can send out 2, 3, 4, 5 setups in one day.
I think when doing that, though, come armed with a contract, right? You want to have a written agreement. You don't want to be ripped off or have the company that you work with like try to like take the event like for next year. You know what I mean? Like you should have a come prepared.
Right. And try to be the point person.
Yeah.
Be the point person in the conversations with the client, because if you're the point person, that's who they're going to go to the next time that they want to book an event. And I think you have the conversation like, hey, I want to bring you in, whatever the split is. Maybe it's 50-50. Maybe it's 60-40. Maybe it's 80-20. I don't know what it is. That's something you need to figure out and negotiate. But be the point person. Get the contract signed. Make sure you take care of that part of it. And I think that would be really important in ensuring that you're going to get the follow-up business.
Yeah, because a lot of these, I've seen you guys worked with Google how many years in a row? Like a lot of that's repeat business. A lot of these things are repeat business.
Yeah, it's just like anything else. It's a relationship with the person who's in charge of booking the entertainment, and you keep that relationship and you do a great job and you over deliver on whatever your offer or promise was.
Yeah, because like you said, just like everything else, that person could move on to another business, but now you also have other contacts at that previous account. Yeah. And then that's how you're going to grow.
You know how I get those bookings? Most of the time, it's from people that know me from nightlife that just ask and say, hey, I don't know if you do this, but if you do, I have this opportunity.
Right.
So instead of waiting for people to come to you, go on the offense, go on the attack, make it known that this is something you do, and be prepared to negotiate and have those conversations and make a simple contract. If you guys need contracts, DM me. I will send you my contract and you can make it your own. Legit.
Yeah.
It's very simple, the one I have.
Like everything else, it's just a lot of prep work just to gear yourself up into this world.
Yeah.
So.
Man, how long have we been going? I haven't really paid attention.
I don't know. Well, I think long enough.
Yeah, we said we got to be quick on this one. We got a lot of stuff to do today. So.
Yeah.
All right. I think this was a good episode. We kind of jumped on a bunch of different topics, but I hope you guys took something away that could help your business. And we're starting to, like Gary and I were saying, like we're starting to get to that planning part of the year where, all right, this year's about done. You know, we're into the fourth quarter. We're almost into holiday season. Once Thanksgiving hits, like that's it. Your year's done, right? And you should start thinking about that 2022. We're definitely going to have one of those podcasts coming up soon. So we'll give you guys some tools and things to be thinking about, but tell us if you book any corporate events. I'm interested to hear if there's something that you put together that helps you book more gigs here in this last couple months of the year. So,
all right, guys,
anything we need to promo? I guess I'll go through real quick where I'm going to be this week. Super easy. Thursday, Tally Ho. You know what it is. Friday, Iron Bar, Morristown. Always a great time. Always great to get out of Hoboken, Jersey City area and go do something different. Play to a little different crowd. It's always fun. Ashford Saturday, Wicked Wolf Sunday, primetime 3 p.m. set. So great weekend lined up for me. It's kind of all one speed, but it should be fun.
Yeah. Sounds packed.
All right, guys, thanks for listening to this episode of The Get Down. My name's Cream.
Gary W.
Talk to you guys next week. Peace.
All right, peace.